those moments will be lost in time. Like tears.
Tim usually starts.
If you could be born in any year, what would it be?
Didn't we do this question already?
No, that was a very different question. That was if you could go back in time or go forward in time. And you also answered that question with what year you'd go back to. But this one, you have to actually live your full life.
How is this a very different question?
It's a very different question, Michael.
But she could give the exact same answer as long as she backdates what year she's born in.
Yeah, but would she want to live in that? In her previous answer, would she actually want to live her entire life? So you'd have to go through, what was that? What was your previous answer to that one? You wanted to be
I was gonna say, let's throw it to the person we're talking about instead of us just is she
I'm right here, guys. 1970s grindhouse New York.
Now what she means by that is no.
Right, but how old would you like to be when that happens?
Like in my 20s. So maybe like 30, late 20s, early 30s.
Late 20s, early 30s. So let's just say
55.
55. Then you'd be 70s.
Born in 50.
So then you'd have to be like, when you're 50 years old, you're 2000s, and then now you'd be 71. You want to be one of those old people who go to Walmart and don't know how to use your phone?
Oh, that would be adorable. I love old people who don't know how to use phones.
Yeah, but if you just reference it based on what you would be today, then there's no good answer other than like not born yet, I guess. Because it's like that's such a weird way to do it, because it's like in every scenario you pick, eventually you'll be an old person.
Yeah, that's but true. When do you want to be?
So
your
that's
old...
like saying anything she'd picked, you'd have been like, oh, so that means you want to be 70 in the 80s, or you want to be 70 in the 50s, you want to be 70. Like, what is the point of bringing that up?
Well, because I mean, there could be like, what if you wanted to be born in 1880.
What is the best time period?
1880, no,
what is
and
the,
then...
Shut the fuck up, Tim.
1880?
What? To you, when is the best time period for you to be an old person?
When is the best time period? Maybe like the Reagan years?
Not a bad answer. And actually, a pretty good segue into the topic at hand. Welcome to Film Runners, the podcast where one of us chooses a film at least one of the others hasn't seen. We watch it and we talk about it. My name is Michael and I'm here with Insha.
Hi.
And Tim.
Hello. And this episode of Film Runners is sponsored by Enamory.com, Fine Art Photography, and Wall Prints.
Farner.
From a very creative couple, Aaron Samberly and Ashton King. Use code RUNNER10 at checkout for 10% off your first order. Look at their abstract and modern pieces.
Really at the bottom of the barrel on these, huh?
They haven't updated their website in a while. Check out their subscription packs, which I've mentioned on previous episodes. They're now available. New art every month.
ENAMRY.com.
Fantastic.
I actually just, to seriously pump them up, I got two art pieces from Ashley that are dope. And four prints, photography prints from Aaron that are dope. So
very cool. What did you get?
I'm excited about those. And they look
pretty
good.
The prints did you get? Were they print out for abstract art, or were they?
Well, I got one was she did a screenshot from the movie Phantom Thread that she drew,
oh, yeah.
And that was actually a Christmas present from Insha to me.
Oh,
yeah. And then her Ashley's Christmas present to me was the last drive-in with Joe Bob Briggs.
Right.
Yeah, like a picture of that in her style, and it's dope as fuck. And then Aaron's are just his photographer. Not just. One is like a cool train picture, and then the rest are like skyscapes.
Very cool.
Yeah, they look good.
Check it. Yeah. Check them out.
ENAMORY.com. All
right. This week, we had a classic Insha pick.
Yeah.
So, Insha, what did you pick for this week's episode?
I picked The People Under the Stairs, directed by Wes Craven. So.
What was that?
So I'm trying to think. So should I just go into the synopsis?
Yeah, it's from 1991. Yeah. Just give a brief synopsis.
Okay. So to not get evicted from their house or home or project or ghetto.
House or home. That's funny.
It just trickles down. Fool and Leroy try to break into the landlord's home after hearing that they have gold, and however the both of them instead get trapped in the house owned by Mommy and Daddy, who are also the landlords, with the help of Roach and Alice. Fool tries to get out of the house in the best way he can without severely dying from a whole multitude of things that can happen, especially a grown man in a gimp suit.
Dying with extreme prejudice.
And
yeah, that's
Michael's seen it. I know Tim hasn't seen it, right?
Correct.
Okay, Michael, go first.
I've seen it several times. Saw it first time as a kid, loved it. Kind of love it each, like, more every time I watch it. I think it's just really fun. It's, I would say, wall to wall perfect performances. Like, just everybody knows exactly what they're doing. Even the main character is like a kid, and he's good. He's really good.
Mm-hmm.
Which helps since we follow him for the majority of it. But it's like a fucking twisted fairy tale. It's Wes Craven. It's funny. It's got some good horror moments. It's really creative, and I really like it a lot.
Tim.
Insha, what movie did you make for this?
A really good one.
What is this? I could not understand what I... Like, it felt to me like a movie that didn't know what it wanted to be, because, like...
No, I disagree.
No, it's just so... It's like, what audience is this for? I couldn't figure this out. Because it felt like a cheap 90s Disney movie for kids at some point, and then
yes.
Total gore, like craziness on the other end with yes. some, you know, F-bombs and hard R's thrown around. So like
there's only one hard R. I counted.
There
that.
Is only one. Okay. Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know, guys.
You don't know your initial impressions of
it? It's okay not to know, Tim.
Well, I'll no, it you. Isn't. It I'll, actually, I'll... no. Here's the thing. Don't listen to her, because this is all about us talking about the film, so it isn't okay. You need to verbalize your opinion on it. Like, talk it through. Sure, talk it through, but it's not okay to just not know.
No, this movie's I'll not show for... you this worse movie things. Was not made for me, I can tell you that much right now.
That's fair, because it was definitely made for me. It's a it's a fantasy story. I told you that. Like, it's a fairy tale. It's a twisted fairy tale.
Yes.
It's like, that's like if you watched like an adaptation of Hansel and Gretel and you were like, a house made of candy, who is this for? What's going on here? And then she wants to bake them in the oven? What's going on?
I don't know. It's just, it felt so weird. Like, it felt like I was watching like The Sandlot or at sometimes Ace Ventura, yeah. Right? Like,
wait, Ace Ventura?
The dad had some real Jim Carrey vibes going on.
I have to really admit, dead. Yeah.
I don't get Jim Carrey. Oh, like, but he's so definitely
in the scene where he used the bayonet to stab the dog and then like jumped around and said, I got him.
Prove it.
Oh, that didn't feel Jim Carrey-ish to me. But I really like that part because while daddy's doing that, mommy's just staring at him like totally not into his dancing and cheering, just like, and then she's like, where's the fucking body? And he's like celebrating. Yeah, it definitely, I mean, it's got a quirky vibe. That's for sure. That's absolutely sure.
And like,
but it is, it's like,
I felt myself,
I get Sandlot is a very good comparison, I think.
Yeah, I think, I mean, the dog probably helped, right? Like, the there's several scenes in this where the dog was like attacking people or like a low angle, but wait, where the dog was running at them, which is, they probably scene for scene the exact same style that they use in Sandlot with that dog.
But it also, like, like the child main character gives it that vibe, like sort of Goonies-ish too.
Oh yeah.
Also, like.
Well, and that's what I mean. Like, it was that, so which, you know, the audience is obviously kids for that one, but then with all this very mature subject matter surrounding it, so for me, like, it was too much of a clash for me, I think.
It's, but that's so weird because it's like you're worrying about the audience. You're the audience currently watching it. Like, worry about how it makes you feel, not like who is supposed to be.
Well, that, like, that's what it made me feel. Like, if I was like, watching a movie...
That's, like, executive mindset. It's like, well, this isn't a four-quadrant hit. I don't know who this is for.
No, it's more like, I'm watching this... Like, if I'm watching Sandlot, I'd be like, okay, you know, this is a kid's movie. It's got some goofy, weirdo things. Haha, whatever. And then, if I'm watching, like, a horror movie, then I'm watching a horror movie. I don't know if my brain can handle two... Complete opposite styles.
I agree with you there. I don't think your brain can handle two things either. I agree with you.
I'm very confused about what you're saying about two different things.
I am too, because it's so weird because, like, as a kid, I watched straight up normal horror movies. And also, I would argue Goonies is a lot creepier than this movie.
Yes.
Like, Goonies creeped me out as a kid. Like, the Fratellis were fucking terrifying. Whereas in this, Mommy and Daddy are so... They're pitched to the fucking rafters that it's like, as also, oh, I will say, sorry, the cat's in front of the microphone. I will say,
hi Kelly.
As goofy as Mommy and Daddy are, when the first time we see him in the gimp suit, it's a pretty effective, like, what the fuck is going on? Like,
because
he just pops out and he's wearing the gimp suit
for no reason.
We're like,
yeah,
no, other than it looks creepy. Like, they're freaks. They're fucking freaks.
There's probably a reason, but we just need a backstory.
We need some exposition here.
I really, really, like, that's the one note that I wrote down. It's just, like, I just want an entire front story of how this gimp suit got brought out. Like, did it get brought out, like, when they were, like, playing house, and they were like, we want to play house forever, we're Mommy and Daddy, but also I need you to put on the suit whenever you're killing somebody. Like, I just want to know what happened. How did that go from A to B?
Well, that's a good point.
He likes wearing the gimp suit.
Well, here's the thing, is that he just killed Ving Rhames, and then he runs upstairs, and like within the next scene he's running around chasing after Fool. So like, he's gotta be a pretty quick changer to go from there and put on this entire complex suit within maybe a few minutes.
We don't know how complex it is. He may have like a nice easy access, like a...
It doesn't look like nice leather setup, which is nice.
It's leather. You ever try and put leather on, Michael?
No.
It's complicated.
Sticks.
I'll take your guys' word for it. But, I mean, he's been doing it for a while. I'm sure he can get it done fast.
Did it give you Batman vibes?
No. I mean, sure, yes, in the sense that he was like a grown man.
No, but it's got like, it had like the eye slits.
Oh, when he has,
and it goes down to like the nose to look kind of like a beak, like Batman does.
Now I know what you mean, when he has the full headgear on. So. Yeah. Yes.
Right.
More like, almost more like, weirdly, Big Daddy from Kick-Ass. Like,
oh,
Nick Cage's character. Speaking of, can we talk about Ving Rhames? Because he is... fucking fantastic in this movie.
He's so good.
Because his character on paper is such a piece of shit who, like, base almost beats up his girlfriend, like, definitely manhandles her, and then forces a 13-year-old to break into a house with him. But he's so fucking charming that I just love him. Like, I fucking love him, man.
I do.
And, oh, sorry.
No, go.
He has two amazing lines in it that I mean, every line he says is gold, but,
13th birthday is unlucky anyway. Too old to get tit, too young to get ass. Fucked out of the way.
And then another line, he said,
maybe Spencer should stick his ugly head out and give us some kind of a signal.
Maybe looking around a little bit. Make sure it's safe.
Maybe the president is gonna make me secretary of pussy.
And I'll cut the bim bum there because it's Ving Rhames delivering it, and it's beautiful. It's so good.
Was the dad, I don't know if I call him dad, the man.
Daddy?
Call him daddy.
Was he chewing on Ving Rhames, like, when he was cutting him up?
Yes.
I think so. I think it's implied that they're all cannibals.
Yes.
Because at the first thing we see, he's, like, eating that big rack of ribs and spitting out buckshot.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Another thing, lending to your, Tim, your, this is a kids movie vibes, is how fucking goofy... Leroy, who's Ving Rhames' plan, Leroy and Spencer, his like friend, their plan with Fool to break into the house is very like costume oriented, like a lot of costume changes involved.
It's super like, it's quite, bare bones. Quite the scheme.
Yeah, they set him in as like a Boy Scout, and then that doesn't work, and then they immediately go in as like the from the gas company. And it's like that's so dumb. Like it's so obviously these people who like rarely ever get. Visitors, it's like two in a row being like, can I come into your house, please?
I got, I'll say again, I got Home Alone vibes from that. Like Joe Pesci coming up in the police outfit.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then later, like, when the man gets punched in the nuts.
Call him Daddy.
Just call him Daddy. Is his name Tim. Daddy? It's so much easier, yes.
Okay.
It's Mommy and Daddy. He gets punched in the nuts. They're credited as the man and the woman, but they're Mommy and Daddy.
Right. When he gets punched in the nuts, I think that's a very Home Alone scene, too.
Yeah, there's some little rascals, too.
It's half a comedy, Tim.
It is. It's a comedy. It is a comedy.
It's a very much a comedy.
But it's a very funny movie.
I do love Ving Rhames' character because of the fact that he kind of... From that point, not throughout the movie because he dies, but from that point before the robbery when he's talking to Fool and Ruby, like he's realistic about it.
He's right.
Yeah, like he's absolutely
saying it
right.
As an asshole. You're right, yeah. He's saying it as a prick, like he's being a dick about it, but he is 100% correct.
He tried to put food on the damn table, and that's what I'm trying to teach the boy to do.
He wants to be a doctor.
You can't even afford to pay rent. How the hell are you going to afford to send him to medical school?
They're right anyway.
Oh, that right. You know your mama got a cancer in her she can't afford to have taken out?
Leroy!
Yeah, the thing any doctor could take out just like that. But you ain't got no money. And you ain't going to have no money unless you... You little snot. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. You listen up, you little punk. Listen up. Now, this is the big one, and somebody deserved to be robbed. Somebody who don't care nothing about families or about the neighborhood. He just want to bring the wrecking ball in so he can line his pockets.
Who are you talking about?
The landlord, that's it.
The landlord of this building?
Yeah. I found a treasure map last night in the back room of the liquor store me and Spencer hit. A letter addressed to the owner along with the name of his company.
So?
So the name of the company is the same as the name on your eviction notice. Same guy who owns the liquor store owns this building and half the buildings in the ghetto. I know where your landlord lives.
Like, I felt bad. Like, I felt... Like, me and Michael have had this conversation where it's kind of just like the Tony Stark kind of a version of it where it's just like, oh, send kid in to do your thing. But it's like, I was like, I mean, if you live in the, like, if you live in the projects, you live in the ghetto, you have this mindset of, like, get-rich-quick schemes, and, like, you are, like, a person of color, that is your thing. Like, that's just, like, go get the gold, steal from, like, it's a Robin Hood complex, and I think that works so well for his character, because he's such an asshole, but it's just, I'm like, you're right.
And it helps that they're specifically targeting, like, all we know Leroy hit was the liquor store, which I think was owned by Mommy and Daddy too, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And Mommy and Daddy, who were very predatory, like, they're preying, literally preying on on the poor and the unfortunate and shit like that. So you couldn't have picked a better target. I would also argue, going back to what you said about Tony Stark, Leroy, as a person, is a better person than Tony Stark ever
Absolutely.
Was.
No, 100%.
Well, I don't think there's any proof that Leroy was a war criminal, so I think think you're probably right on that.
Exactly. Right? Right? See what I'm saying?
To go back to what you were saying, too, I mean, it does... There is a lot of theme of, like, privilege in there. Because like, when the cops show up, they just kind of go through the entire house, and it's no big deal, right?
I think the first
time the cops show up, they don't even go through the house. Like, the first time the cops show up, they just talk about they see the, like, busted door, and they're like, oh, no, we look through the house, it's fine. And the cops are like, okay, we'll just walk around the neighborhood.
Insane. Insane. That bugged me so much, because I'm just like, I've been in those situations where, like, people will go... This movie is great with race, and Wes Craven has always been really, really, really great with, like, stuff having to do with, like, real life. And, like, this, I'm like... You, like, even with the scene with Fool going in the Boy Scout uniform, and then he's, like, she's just like, no, goodbye, peace, and then she lets, like, the white guy in. I'm just like, what?
It is like Wes Craven doing an almost John Carpenter-esque, like, very blunt commentary, because it's... You know, it's over the top. There's no, like, nuance to it. Like, it's very obvious, like, these... Nancy and Ronald Reagan caricatures literally preying on and eating like poor people and black people and children, and yeah, it's, which is good, like, it's fun, it's good, like, I think, maybe not, but I think Wes Craven is really good at comedy, and John Carpenter is too, but I think Craven's probably better at comedy, so it's a good way to do it.
He's good at balancing it, like, Carpenter's kind of good at just, like, putting it on the table, saying it, walking away from it, and being like, if you have questions, see me after class. But, like, Craven is just like, this is hilarious because this is so wrong.
See, I will say that's right, because I was thinking of that earlier, is that, because, like, Scream is a funny movie. What I was talking about earlier, where, like, you know, this one kind of had two genres didn't to mix. I found, like, Scream was a better way of weaving in the comedy with the horror aspect, where... Like,
I see that, because I think the horror aspect of that is slightly more realistic, so it, like, and the humor is more, like, realistic, so they meld together maybe a little better.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Whereas this is, like...
Two sides humor, of a coin, my friend.
Yeah.
It's, like, too real or too funny.
Yeah. Like, I think Scream is the better movie, but I still think they're both, like, great movies. I like them both. I really liked when the cops, when Fool escapes the house, and then the cops, then he calls the cops and saying, like, oh, I think a child's being abused in this house or whatever, and the cops show up, and Daddy's dressed up, it's extremely raggedish, he's smoking a pipe, he's got a sweater vest and, like, that dumb, like, 80s or 90s, like, old man hat, like, baseball hat, but it looks like, it literally looks like something Reagan or, like, George W. Bush would have worn to look like down to earth, but he just looks so, like, put on, like, he's like, I'm a normal upstanding white man,
right? And then he does that, like, Abbott and Costello kind of bit where he pulls his hair, his hat up, pokes his, like, open wound and puts it back down before the cops could see it. Just weird, just a weird movie.
It is I have a question for Tim.
Okay,
what did you think, so when Alice gets fed, and then Mommy is taking the plate back, and the fork's missing. And then Alice is looking for it. And then the hand reaches out of the wall and hands her the fork. What were your thoughts when that happened? When Roach handed the fork back?
Well, I got... Like, I thought that that was going to be... Because I had no idea what this movie was about. So I had no idea where it was going. So I assumed, like... Like, at that point, I was like, okay, is it, like, one person in the walls that's going to terrorize this pretty fine family? I think that was before she was
terrorized. Pretty fine family.
They were creepy
about
this
point.
What are
you watching, Tim?
But then she, like, taps the hand, so I was like, okay, well, maybe it's okay then.
This pretty fine family.
You know, they're a little strict, but, you know, nothing too quite...
Seem nice, fun, and totally upstanding citizens. Yeah.
There was no evidence to say the otherwise.
I don't know what it is about him, but I don't like it. That's funny. What did you think of Roach in general?
I liked Roach, and I was sad that he died so quickly, to be honest with you. He died halfway through the movie.
Yeah, he's very cool. Roach, Roach rules.
I was hoping that Tim liked Roach. That's all I needed for that.
I also love when Daddy is, like, chasing Fool, and then Roach opens the medicine cabinet and like pulls him in and then shuts it, and Daddy is so confused about how to get into the, like clearly the people under the stairs have like retrofitted the house to have these secret compartments that even Mommy and Daddy don't know about, because he just like blasts it with the shotgun. He's so mad.
Okay, so here's the other thing about this, like, what is this house with trapdoors? Like, who built it? I have so many questions about this house.
I was actually thinking about that too when I was watching, because I was just like, is this their family's house? Like, was this passed down?
Yes.
To them? It was passed down to them, right?
Because mentioned it was a funeral home. So I'm not surprised it's huge. Yeah. Like, that makes sense. Right.
Yep.
But yeah, obviously it's very fantasy-ish that you could like move through the walls like this and even fucking live. Like, they have like a dozen zombies living in the fucking basement.
And at one point, she, like, jumps up through the oven hood? The stove hood?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. At my house, there's, like, there's an itty-bitty fan, so...
it's fantasy logic. I don't know. At that point,
it's like once there's a portal happens, in there.
But they don't trick you by having it be, like, super realistic and then that happens.
I think
the whole movie is goofy.
I think the suspension of belief is with Tim in this. It's gone. It's just like, I can't suspend the belief enough to know that people live in the walls.
it's a weird point that the internal mechanisms in a range hood is what turns you off the movie.
But there was little itty-bitty, like, trapdoors all over the place. Like, everything could be a trapdoor.
Yeah. That was cool. I like that.
I love... I do love, like, house... I love houses. Like, I love houses in movies where you can just get into everything. Like, even in the walls, in the cabinet, like, through the stove. So I'm like, it's a fantasy type of a situation. It's kind of just like... Here, imagine if Studio Ghibli did that. Would that be cool?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it'd be nicely animated.
Tim's like, castles don't move. Castles don't move. I think it looked good. I thought it was a really good looking movie.
I don't know. I just had more questions about who these people were and why they have a house like this.
Honestly, I get that. I had the same questions, but then...
I don't. I'm curious in the sense that, like, I would read a thing about Wes Craven's, like, background for them, but I think the movie gives us exactly as much as they should. I don't want to know. I know them. They're rich conservatives, but pushed to the nth degree, you know?
No, and exactly. Like, I like that. It's just kind of like, it's those little things that I would want to know that, like, I don't necessarily need to know for myself in this movie, but like, I want to know myself, like the gimp outfit, I want to know where that came from. Like, that's still, that would bother me if I was like a different person, but I'm just like, the amount
if I was a worse person, that would bother me. Worse, she says different, she means worse.
like I'm like, I like the amount of gimp outfit that's in here, I don't need to know anymore, but I'm gonna be curious if I like, the question's gonna pop up if I rewatch this. Like, you know?
I love, speaking of the gimp outfit, it looks so good at the end when he's, like, hunting down Fool, and he's been hit on another Home Alone thing when he's hit on the head with the brick.
Yep.
But in this, it actually does damage instead of just, like, being all goofy. And he's, like, hunting down Fool, and he's, I think he's lit overhead or whatever. So he's got the gimp outfit on, and he's, like, a serious look on his face, and he's got, like, bright red blood all over his forehead, and it looks so cool.
I wrote down that... I think Insha likes fucked up family movies.
I do. I very much do. I will admit that. I very much do.
Alright. I found
I will say,
the niche.
Speaking on that, my one biggest, like, the only real complaint I have about the movie is that Alice should have been developed a little more on her own, like her own sort of agency. Like, we know she helps out the people under the stairs, and she helps out Fool, but, and I know it's Fool's story, but she kind of gets a little sidetracked.
I kind of like that, though. The amount of Alice that we get almost puts her Alice in Wonderland in a weird way, mm-hmm. where she's kind of like the bystander of her own story, because, like, even at the end where she's just like, you're lying, they are my parents, or something like that, like, it's just kind of like, she's just breezing, not breezing through it, because that's some fucked up shit that she's going through. But, like, she's living it.
Like, she, yeah, that's the thing. She's like an archetype. Like, it's Fool. Fool is the, you know, I mean, his name's Fool. But he's the guy stumbling through this fairy tale, and she's sort of the damsel in distress. So she does that perfectly fine and well. But I don't know, I kind of wanted more of, like, her relationship with Roach and the other people in the stairs. I like that she was, like, a seemingly normal person helping out, like, with these people who were totally fucked up by mommy and daddy, and she can relate to them because she's fucked up by them too, just not, you know, to the extent where she's been thrown under the stairs yet.
Yeah, I actually have the one quote from her. What was it? Fool says, like, you can see, you've ever seen a brother before? And then she's like, no, a black dude. There's black dudes in this neighborhood. And then she's like, neighborhood? And I was just like, I was like, Alice, without even trying, has single-handedly not shown racial bias.
Yeah. It's so funny. She's almost literally the poster child for, like, I don't see color. I don't know. But then immediately follows it up with, I don't even know what the word neighborhood means. I don't know what you're talking about. I also liked in the finale, because we kept going down to the basement a lot in the finale, on one of the, like, what's it called? Like, beams or whatever, there's a cheap Halloween skeleton decoration, and it made me laugh every time he saw it, because I was just picturing the person on set being like, we're filming a horror movie, just putting up, like, a cheap Halloween skeleton decoration, being like, that's horror-ish, right? That's scary.
So hold on, was that supposed to be a real skeleton, or was it supposed to be a decoration?
No, it was like a plasticky, like...
Yeah, but I thought that was supposed to be like a skeleton.
Like, somebody who's gotten probably decayed over the...
I don't think so, guys. I think it was literally... I don't even think it was, like, 3D. I think it was almost, like, 2D, but kind of, like, bumpy. You know what I mean? Like, one of those plastic...
Yeah, but I just thought that was supposed to be a skeleton. Like, a person who died under the stairs.
No, I think it's literally supposed to be a decoration. Like, I don't think it's the movie pretending it's a skeleton. I think it's a skeleton decoration mommy
This movie is that goofy enough. I was thinking it was...
It could have. I didn't think that. It could have meant that.
I thought the same thing that Tim did.
Yeah, good.
I thought it was a person who just got eaten and their bones just got clean.
Right? Yeah.
But they were still upright against the beam.
Might as well. I mean, like, they were chained up. So you just eat around that.
I don't think so. Maybe I'll have to look back. Now you've got me second guessing, but I'm pretty sure it was solely supposed to be like a Halloween decoration.
I don't think these people celebrate Halloween.
No, but, yeah, because it's not out on the lawn. They just like it in the basement because they're freaks.
Imagine rolling up to that house with a bunch of rocks and broken glass in a pond.
So weird.
Yeah, I like that. I like that when he breaks back in again and Alice tells him, like, oh, you can't get out the same way because Daddy fixed all that shit. It's a good little...
Yeah, like, why wouldn't they just jump again? But, like, it's filled, yeah. So a pond drained of water filled with sharp rocks and broken glass. Yeah. That image, image is in my head now.
That's another very Home Alone type trick.
Right?
Yeah. Also, speaking of Daddy, anytime, I think it's because I rewatched, like, Arrested Development a little while ago, but anytime I saw him in the gimp suit, it made me think of when Tobias was a leather daddy. When he went to the store and got the leather daddy thing.
So weird.
Going back to the basement, though, Tim, you got to give it up to Fool for that genius idea with the coins and the candles.
Oh, yeah, that was really cool. I really like that.
Very, very cool. Very smart. I like that part a lot.
Yeah, you know what? That is something that I have never thought of ever. Like, that's not even, like, a common, like, trope. Like a candle burning a hempen wire or something like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, that's a cliche sort of
time. But it's such a cool, like, time release distraction. Like, it's such a cool idea.
Yeah.
I bet whoever, if that was a Wes Craven's idea, I bet he called it a day after coming up with that. He's like, oh, gonna walk the dog, gonna have a smoke. I don't know if he smoked, but he's like, I'm done for the day.
What a crazy, like... exchange. No, what a crazy value on those coins, though, eh? Like, he had, like, five, and they were saying, like, you'd have enough money to have rent for, like, years?
If these had come from anybody else, I'd tan your hide and make you take them straight back. You know that?
Yes, sir.
Well, figuring the rarity of these, you do have enough to pay your rent for a while. Say, to the year 2000.
And Mama's operation?
And your Mama's operation. Keep hold of these till tomorrow. I'm gonna order an ambulance for your Mama. Tomorrow we'll take those to a good coin dealer, and we'll all be smiling. Meanwhile, you be careful. That brother-sister act you messed with are evil, plain and simple.
Wait a minute, brother and sister?
Brother and sister.
Yeah, and then also for the mom's cancer stuff?
Yeah, like rent for 10 years and her operation. And it was, you're right, it was like 5 or 6 coins. Even if they were pure gold.
Well, pure gold, they wouldn't be worth that much.
Exactly, that's what I mean. Mm-hmm. Like, but I guess they were rare coin? Or rare
that's
coin
what I think Grandpa coin? Was saying.
I guess so, yeah.
Also, I love the grandfather so much because he started telling the story of like, oh, they're brother and sister. And Fool goes, brother and sister.
What?
It's such a... This is the type of shit that white people do, and yeah. I am not about it.
Oh, yeah. It's all I kept thinking of too when they were calling each other mommy and daddy. Like, remember Mike Pence used to call his wife mother, which is such a gross old timey thing. Like,
yeah.
Oh, you see the news today, mother? They're up to no good down at the ghetto. But it's even creepier when it's brother and sister. Somehow, it's creepier than Mike Pence.
I agree, though. I really like the grandpa. I've seen him. I can't think of...
Bill Cobbs. We saw him. We just saw him in Demolition Man.
Yes. Yes. That's exactly where I saw him.
He's great. He's a fantastic actor. I think... Is he dead now?
I think he's probably dead now, recently? Yes.
No, still alive. 86.
Oh, my God.
Hey.
Good for him. He's great. He pops up and shit, and I'm excited. He was in The Sopranos, 6 Feet Under.
He was in The Sopranos?
Yeah, he's in an episode where he, like, I think he won't move out of an apartment and, like, Tony has to take care of it because, you know, when Tony's working with, like,
that older man. He's that dude. He's that dude's dad.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Sounds like this movie. So he...
Kind of.
He's in an apartment. Purely... They didn't want to move out. They wanted to destroy it to build condos or whatever.
And he was in Demolition Man, so he purely acts in social satire. What did you guys think of Prince, the Rottweiler?
Beefy boy, but seemed like
a... He's a beefy boy. He's a cutie pie, too.
Yeah,
sure. He
but
was,
also
yeah.
a prick.
Yeah.
I laughed hard at the scene where... and I don't know why, so Ving Rhames is playing. This is before he dies, obviously. But Leroy and Fool are there, and they've blocked the door, and Mommy and Daddy can't get in, but they're able to let Prince in. And Ving Rhames' plan is for Fool to stand in the middle of the living room. Ving Rhames will hide... And when Prince goes to attack Fool, Ving Rhames will kill him. Which, I was like, that's a fine plan, but I thought he was going to hide by the side of the door, but he hides behind the couch, behind Fool.
Right.
So it's like, how are you going to get to Prince in time? But it's very funny when Prince rushes in, stops, and looks at Fool, doesn't care about him, and then looks over at the couch, and Fool is like, oh, fuck, or whatever. And Ving Rhames pauses it. Like, Prince just knows. He's like, no, you're not the most dangerous person in here.
Another stupid Home Alone-y moment was when he, like, Prince was attacking Ving Rhames, and Fool grabs Ving Rhames and the door and the electric shock chain all
the electrified door. Yeah.
Just
so funny.
Just dumb.
So funny.
What did you guys think about the ending with, like, all the money and everybody collecting it on the front yard?
I love them. Good for them.
I like
right?
it. It's great.
Isn't that great?
It's so happy. And with all the people under the stairs just quietly, like, wandering off, like, leaving. Like, fuck this, and leaving.
Yeah.
While everyone's celebrating.
Yeah, I thought it was really cool. I don't know.
It's good. It's a nice, happy ending. Unequivocally. Like, Mommy and Daddy are dead. We can all party. And that should be the moral of every movie, as far as I'm concerned.
It did kind of seem like a big party at the end, right? Like, they were all...
They are
it was like Mardi Gras out there.
Yeah. And I think it's because the credit music cuts in, like, earlier than the credits do, but it did seem like they were literally going to start having, like, a block party on the front lawn.
Might as well.
Fuck yeah. Go in there and get those coins.
Yeah, they're, like, worth, I don't know, hundreds of thousands of dollars of each.
Give everyone 6 coins and they're set for life. And there were so many coins. He had like 20 years, 30 years worth of rent stuffed into candles.
Yeah, he was burning those coins. Like, that's going to reduce their value.
I don't think so, Tim. I don't think that's how coins work. Remember that, did you guys watch that Mormon murder doc?
I think my wife watched it. I think Rachel watched it.
But the guy who was, like, forging Mormon documents or whatever, he said he started out by taking coins, and he was able to, like, alter the coins to make them seem like rarer coins. Which is crazy to me. Like, cause, I don't know. I want a whole documentary about how he was able to do that and who was the fucking idiot who bought it. Like, because he said he was, like, 11, 12 years old with, like, it looked like he had a soldering iron. And he was just changing details on coins to make them, like, rarer coins. And it's like, if you're buying rare coins, you should be able to tell whether a 12-year-old is fucking you up.
Right.
Anyway, I don't know what made me think of that. Oh, yeah, burning coins. But when that moment popped up in the documentary, I wanted to pause it and, like, I wish there was an option saying, do you want a documentary about this fucking idiot who bought the coins? Big shout out to Everett McGill and Wendy Robie, I believe, who are mommy and daddy, and their husband and wife in Twin Peaks. And Everett McGill pops up as a henchman in a couple of cool action movies. He's the main bad guy in Silver Bullet, too, the werewolf in Silver Bullet. But anyway, they're both really good and really good together.
Yeah.
And it was fun seeing, because in Twin Peaks, like, Everett McGill plays a very cool, normal schmo who's very put upon. And Wendy Robie basically plays the same character as she does in this movie. So it was fun seeing, like, Everett McGill match that energy in this.
Like I said, like, he was very Jim Carrey to me. I'm surprised he didn't do more comedy in the 90s. Like,
that's why I agree that he's very good in this and funny in this or whatever, but he's mostly known for playing, like,
right,
normal stoic dudes. Like, yeah, very quiet and, like, severe dudes.
Have you ever seen Twin Peaks, Tim?
No, I've never watched it.
Tim wouldn't like Twin Peaks.
Mm.
He's got a very serious face.
He does, yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So I see.
He, but also, he's got one of the most romantic storylines in Twin Peaks, which is wild.
Oh, I thought you were talking about this movie.
Oh.
Well, yeah, this too.
R.I.P. Peggy Lipton.
I know.
But, he really does. Like, Michael's right. Like, the story between his character and Peggy Lipton's character is, like, it's heartbreaking. But it is so beautiful.
There's a moment, you won't watch it, Tim, so I don't care about spoiling it. Okay. But in Twin Peaks The Return, like, the third season they did, like, 20-odd years later, or 30 years later, or whatever, there's a moment where he's sitting at a counter listening to, I think it's an Otis Redding song, and then Peggy Lipton, and just, it's just him, like, vibing to the song, and then you see Peggy Lipton's hand slide over, and she's not on screen, but just her hand, like, slides onto his shoulder. When I tell you I bawled when I saw it for the first time, it's, like, literally, like, 30 years worth of payoff of this just, like, stone-faced actor being a romantic lead. It's so good. Anyway, he's really good. And that's very funny that you were like, oh, I'm surprised he's not in a shitload of comedies in the 90s, because I do not.
I know, he just had a lot of energy in his performance.
He did have a lot of energy. Another really funny line that he delivered was when, is it when he's in the room with Alice or something? But Prince is barking really hard at the door, and he just turns and he's like, shut the fuck up. And it's so funny. I think I'm going to put it at the very end after the outro song. It's a very funny delivery of shut the fuck up.
He's got a lot of noise problem in this house with the shit in the basement, people in the walls, and this dog barking all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it must be.
But it's soundproof. The whole house is soundproof.
From the outside, yeah, but you imagine living there and trying to sleep.
Ugh.
Yeah, the people under the stairs would annoy me if I was trying to sleep. But also, I probably wouldn't put people under the stairs. So it's not really a problem I would have had.
So what? Tell me about these people under the stairs.
Yeah,
besides
so
Roach,
think,
I get Roach.
I was just going to mention it. I think what it is that they were kidnapping or taking in children, mm-hmm, trying to make the perfect child for them. And obviously, these kidnapped kids weren't perfect for them. because like they said, like, see no evil, speak no evil, hear no evil, or whatever. So anytime they were like too much to handle, they would cut out their tongues, or like,
did they cut
out their eyes, or
did they cut their dick off?
Like,
no,
I don't know. But if they were, they would just throw them under the stairs and be like, "Bleh," then you could just eat humans.
Because I think Alice,
and then get a new kid.
Because I think Alice says that they cut his evil off, and I got that as
cut his evil.
Cut their
dick. Oh, they cut they cut whatever part of them that did the wrong. Because it's the see,
yeah,
it's
see,
the hear, and it's the talk.
Yeah. I didn't see any blind ones.
Well, none of them probably. Well, none of them were going to say what they saw.
Wow.
But,
wow.
I mean, well, you know.
If you see, you think one of those kids didn't see him in the gimp suit?
How would that be the kid's fault?
That's evil. Michael, that's evil.
Yeah.
I'm also kind of curious with the, with all of the people in the basement, because like all the people in the basement were boys, and Alice specifically said that they were trying to make the perfect boy child. Mm-hmm. But then I'm like, so why did you, like, did you get tired of boys and was just like, Alice?
Maybe. They seemed to have better success. Unless they were trying to have, like, two.
That's what I was thinking, and is Alice was fine and they couldn't get a boy.
Well, yeah.
Or maybe Alice was first and they wanted a boy.
Although I feel like the people under the stairs seemed older than Alice. They like, they tried with older. A bunch of boys.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Anyway.
So I don't know. I don't know.
Okay, so what made them crazy, though?
They've been living underneath the stairs.
Yeah, you mean the people under the stairs?
Yeah, I mean, like, let's go back to the loved ones.
Their traumas.
Where they gave them lobotomies.
They're living underneath the stairs.
Yeah, yeah, they're traumas.
And they've probably had something of themselves cut out. And they have, like, they've become reduced to cannibals because, like, they have no food, no water, no source of light. Like, the TV is their best friend.
Yeah, they've just been abused and traumatized.
Yeah.
And honestly, they're hungry, but I wouldn't call them crazy, because at the end, they're fine. They kill mommy and then leave. Like, they're fine.
Yeah.
Ooh, you know what a good example is? In the loved ones, the people in that basement, same exact thing.
No, they were lobotomized.
That's what Tim brought that up, though. They were lobotomized.
Oh, they weren't lobotomized. But still,
these guys,
you know, they've been in the dark. But they're cannibals.
same basic concept. Like, just stuck... they were tortured. Like, they're tortured.
So here's
tortured people.
So here's another thing. So
tortured people, tortured people.
That's the expression. Daddy threw Fool into the pit of the people under the stairs, right? Expecting them to, like, attack or eat him, right?
Eat him. Yeah.
Okay, so this kind of happened in the loved ones, too, where, like, why do... they think that they're going to eat this person when there have been other people in here that they haven't eaten before.
Do we know there have been other people?
Yeah, okay. How many people were under the stairs? Like 10, let's say. What happens when the 11th kid comes in here? Are they going to eat them? No, because then it wouldn't have had 10 people. Like, how did the 9th get in there? Or how did the 8th person get in there? The 7 didn't eat them.
No, but I mean, they might if they're hungry enough. Presumably, they would just eat the people that are provided as food.
And it was that in the love lives. The first lobotomized kid was put underneath the floor. And then when the second lobotomized kid, why didn't the first lobotomized kid kill this one? But they expected the other kid, though. Like it's a known thing.
Okay, one, I would say, first of all, this is a stupid question because it's all based on fairy tale logic.
Right.
Ooh. But two, to answer your question... I would say the people who, the failed children, in quotes, who they're like, no, this kid's no good, put them under the stairs, that they're put down there alive. Whereas I feel like most of the people they throw down there for the people under the stairs to eat are already dead.
Right, so why did they know to eat them? Why did he, the daddy, expect them to kill Walt, who was, Walt, no, that's a different
Walt.
Kid. Fool, who's clearly alive.
I don't know. Maybe he didn't. Maybe he was like, well, fine, he can just live under the stairs if they don't want to eat him.
Yeah. Or just, like, at least tear him apart. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
All right, you don't know. That's fine.
You don't know. I can't make you know. It's fine. What are we going to do? Force you to know?
I like how his nickname was Fool, but his real name was Poindexter.
It is cool. I do like that they clarify at the very beginning. Ruby's cool, too.
I like Ruby a lot.
Yeah, Ruby was dope. But that whole intro of the tarot cards or whatever, and they clarify about, like, oh, he's not a fool that he's dumb. He's a fool that he hasn't.
He's ignorant. To, or right?
is, yeah, 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 ignorant. Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, he's not stupid. He's ignorant. I think that's what she says.
Yeah.
Tough road you got this year. Judgment. Death. And Mr. Devil. Glad it's your birthday reading and not mine. Now here's your card, fool. See? That's where I got your nickname.
Don't remind me.
Here you go, 13 today. The golden-haired birthday boy is setting off on life's big adventure.
I ain't no golden-haired nobody. Now I'm going off to a seventh grade.
Well, you the fool and you can't escape that. That ain't bad.
No?
Nah, ain't the stupid kind of fool. Only the ignorant kind, because you're just starting out.
That's better, I guess.
Oh, but look here. Already he's got a problem, see? One step in front, the drop-off.
Well, what about the dog?
That's Fool's companion. See his spirit barking?
Fool, don't go marching over that cliff now. Do the smart thing, the high thing.
So what Fool gonna do if he ain't gonna go off the cliff? Fly? He gonna do what he had to, Fool. Turn around, walk the other way. Right through the fire of the sun.
He get burned up if he do that.
Just the boy part get burned up. Rest come out the other side of man. And no one calls him fool again.
Yeah.
I really
that intro is very cool. And that with the it just being like tarot cards with Ruby like narrating shit sets up again that sort of fairy tale. Like it feels like pages of a book, sort mm-hmm. of like narration of like this world, and then you see the world.
Mm-hmm.
Like the beginning of Shrek. One of my recommendations is Shrek. No, I'm kidding. No.
I like that intro too, because like the card, like, oh, nobody reads tarot cards here except for me. But like the intro, like tarot cards, it basically sets up the entire story without really setting it up. And I'm like, that's interesting. I like that a lot.
Yeah, going, like, I meant to pay attention or like go back to the beginning, but when she describes. When she's talking about the card, like, how there's a cliff, and then there's the sun and shit, and it's like, well, what do? You turn your back and walk into whatever. I was like, oh, does that relate to, like, the finale? Because there's that big explosion at the end.
Mm-hmm. And even, like,
but
the...
Even,
like, the devil and death kind of, like, relate to... death kind of relates to, I think, Alice in a weird way. Not meaning, like, actual death, but, like, a new beginning for Alice. And then the devil is obviously either the two people, well, mommy and daddy, being greedy and stuff like that. And those, like, those are, like, the devil's the obstacle that he has to overcome, like, the fool, in order to get to his beginning or his new journey and doing all this other stuff. So I was really, really intrigued by, like, the kind of setup that they have with the tarot cards. I'm like, ooh.
The problem is, though, he's 13. He's too old to get hit and too young to get ass. It's fucked either way.
I kind of started chuckling at my it's such a fucking white people moment.
All right, I guess we're on to cameo. But now I know you're just a cameo.
Yeah.
All right.
Whose is it?
It's a Tim week this week.
Yeah, classic Tim cameo.
And I have a guy named Sean Whalen. You might know him from, Froger.
The People Under the Stairs.
Oh, is he in this? He's Froger in Lost. And,
yep.
He's a character actor. He's been doing this stuff for a while.
He's in the first season of Superstore, too.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah.
And he was in this movie playing Roach. He is usually responds in one day. He has 17 reviews, all 5 stars, and oh, he was in Twister too.
He's
I just remembered his character in Lost.
Yeah, he's Neil Froger. He just bitches for a bit and then he gets hit with a flaming arrow in an episode. So funny. He's such a niche, like, to me, cameo is built for, like, an actor like him. Like, he's a great actor. Like, I love him when he pops up and shit. But it's, like, he's not, you know, he's not famous or whatever. So it's an easy way for him to make some walking around money, you know?
Yeah, I agree.
And, yeah.
Some Chili's money.
Like, presumably he doesn't get a lot of hits. And presumably he doesn't charge a lot. But I'm glad that he's got at least 17, right, from the reviews?
Yeah. But I 100% agree. Like, he is making, I don't know how much he's making, but he's making the minimum wage for actors, I assume. Like, he...
Yeah, SAG minimum, for sure. Yeah, he's a working actor. Like, yeah. And he's a type, you know, so I've seen him in stuff regularly, but, you know, he's not leading anything.
No, and to get some extra bucks on the side, this is the type of cameo that I'm happy is available.
And he doesn't have to, like, schlub his way to a Comic-Con or something to do it. He can just do it from the comfort of his own home and, you know, treat his family to dinner one night off of it, which is nice.
So, yeah, and I watched his, his intro video. He seems like a really genuine, nice guy. He said, that you would, you could book him for birthdays or weddings or to fire somebody. So.
That's really funny.
He's precious.
I mean, I hope no one actually takes him up on that, but it's very funny that he said that. Although I wouldn't hire him. I would hire Shooter McGavin to fire somebody if I was a real prick.
That's true, too. And he seems to, like, do him in front of, like, a gray sheet of some sort of background that he puts up. You know, he's taking the time. It's not like he's in a car on the way to Jamba Juice.
Right.
And
or just laying in bed. Or walking through the mall. Yeah, like, not much effort. He probably just pinned a sheet up, but at least he's, you know, making it as neutral and less distracting as possible.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is good. I would like to kick it off by saying I think he charges $40. I think it might be too much, but I think he's worth at least $40, so I'm gonna say $40.
Alright. $40.
Oh, shit. I was gonna say $30.
Say 30.
I'm gonna do the Price is Right thing. I'm gonna say 35.
Oh shit.
If I said he had 30 members in his fan club, would that change any of your bids?
No, but I'm happy that he has that. That's crazy. Seriously. That seems like a lot.
Yeah. Insha is exactly right. He is $35.
Oh, yay!
$35.
Yeah, right, no, that makes sense. That makes sense.
That seems so cheap to me. Like,
it does seem cheap,
but
I mean, he knows his niche, right? Yeah. Like, he knows people aren't gonna.
Well, that's I think
aren't gonna pay. Like you can't do more than 50 if you're an actor like him, right? Because nobody's gonna pay that.
I think you're right. I think you're right. 50, like, not more than 50, but 50 seemed like the amount. Like, I would have expected him to be 50. 35 is, I don't know. Like I think you could find a person that'd be like, hey, you like Lost? Here's Frogert, or
yeah, but that's a disappointing. Honestly, this movie would be the better example. Being like, hey, you like People Under the Stairs? This is Roach. That's absolutely worth $50. But if somebody was like, I got you a Lost cameo, honestly, maybe the last person I would want would be Neil Frogert.
But people are like, somebody got it for one of the birthday celebration ones I saw. Was he said, oh, you liked my when I was in Twister, and then he told like a little story of how he got the part.
That's very cool.
That's so being sweet.
In Twister. Apparently, Spielberg saw him in a Got Milk commercial and said, I want him.
He's in the Aaron Burr commercial, the famous one that Michael Bay directed. Remember that one?
Jesus Christ.
He mentioned it. Do you guys remember that commercial?
I do.
Yeah, where it's him and he's eating a peanut butter sandwich and he's listening to the radio and it's like a prize for $10,000 or whatever. Can you name the person who shot Alexander Hamilton? And like, you look around the room and it's like an Aaron Burr museum or whatever, and it's got pictures of him shooting Hamilton, and he like calls up and he's like, he's like, but his mouth is full of peanut butter and he has no milk to like wash it down, and then it's like Got Milk.
Right.
I totally forgot that was him, but now that you mentioned it, that's absolutely the most famous thing I know him from, is that Got Milk commercial.
So Michael, is this a $35 for him? Is that a cameo?
Absolutely. That's a deal. That's a steal. Everyone should get a Sean Whalen cameo.
Yeah, why not? Incha?
Absolutely.
$35, why not? Just give it to anybody.
Yeah.
Exactly. Undervalued. I would say this is one to watch. It's undervalued.
Honestly, I looked it up to see what his business rates were, but he doesn't have one. So I wonder if I could get him. I was thinking maybe $35 to give a shout out for film runners. Why not?
Why not? Fuck him. $35.
Let's do it. But yeah, definitely. He's a cameo. Yeah.
Yeah. All three agree. Yeah, definitely.
This has been Cameo. But now I know you're just a cameo.
Good stuff. Film Run, Walk, or Crawl. Insha, you chose the film.
Oh.
How do you feel about it still?
Absolutely.
After this in-depth conversation, have we changed your mind?
No, absolutely not. Film Run. I love it. I love the characters. I love Everett McGill so much.
So good.
Everything about it is great. Wes Craven did an amazing job. I just film run all the way. Tim,
I will also.
Oh, Michael,
I'll go because mine is echo the exact same. Film run across the board. Everett McGill, Wendy Robie, Brandon Adams, and Ving Rhames all fucking deliver, and it's just a fun movie. Every time I see it, I enjoy it more. I love it. Film one.
No, this is a film crawl. Don't watch this movie. Unless, like, it's skippable. I don't know why, what I just watched, and I don't want to watch it again.
I'm going to make you watch it again if we have to do, like, a revisit episode of Film Runner.
Yeah.
You know what? I would watch it again. I'm going to go with film crawl still, but talking to you about this, you guys are maybe convincing me that it's all right. But no, I'm gonna stick with film.
Stick with
it's a film
stick with
belly flop.
If you end up rewatching it sometime, then you could just appreciate what we talked about. Maybe your opinion will change. But yeah, stick firm with Crawl.
Yeah.
Recommendations.
Yeah, if you want to see Brandon, what was his last name? I forgot it. Brandon Adams.
Brandon Adams.
Yeah. If you want to see Brandon Adams again, you can watch the Mighty Ducks. Series of films.
Yep.
And if you want to see more people under the stairs, you can watch Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone.
Shut up. I hate you so much.
Michael?
My recommendations are pretty basic. Just mostly Wes Craven stuff, like the Scream series. Nightmare on Elm Street, but also if you want to see Ving Rhames being badass in another horror movie, watch the Dawn of the Dead remake.
Fucking Harry Potter, we fucking did.
It's your recommendations.
More Wes Craven, The Hills Have Eyes, The Last House on the Left, and Scream. For home invasion movies, watch Funny Games, watch the 2007 version and the 1997 version. Both are great. And if you want to learn about more black horror films throughout the years, this one's included in this documentary called Horror Noir. And it's great. Mm-hmm.
Did you do the first or second Last House on the Left?
I always go with the 1970, whatever that is. Like, I don't care about the 2009 version. It doesn't exist to me.
It has a good cast.
It's a great cast. Yeah. It's a shit story.
Oh, I've seen that one.
Don't they blow his fucking head up with a microphone?
That's the best part of the movie. That's
it is
by
the best
far
part.
The best part of the movie.
But it's literally like the last shot of the movie. Yeah.
He deserved it though. Like he deserved it.
He did deserve it. Yep, I agree. Yeah, good cast. Not a great movie. No, if you want a good Wes Craven remake, I think The Hills Have Eyes remake is much much better.
Yes.
Yeah, it's interesting and good.
I never ever ever watched the new The Nightmare on Elm Street, because that is garbage.
Yeah, that's dog shit. Absolute dog shit.
The Nightmare on Elm Street, like the original or
they remade it.
Yeah.
Rooney Marr is in it. And Jackie
Earle. It has a good cast too.
Jackie
Earle
Haley.
Clancy Brown.
Yeah.
Plays one of the dads.
Is it Kyle Gilner?
Kyle Gilner, yeah. He's very good. It's got a solid cast, but it's dog shit. Yeah. Absolute bad.
It's really bad.
Connie Britton, I think, is Rooney Mara's mom.
Oh my god, she is, yeah.
Yeah. bad movie, bad stuff. Not good. Don't watch. And that's been our anti-recommendation.
I wasn't planning on watching it, so.
Good, don't. I wasn't kidding. Yeah, maybe I mean. Yeah, you're not the daddy of me.
Oh my god, can you imagine if I made, like, Tim watch The Last House on the Left?
Like the original?
Yeah, no.
That would just honestly be the other one.
The other one doesn't exist to me, but the original.
Yeah, yeah.
I've seen it.
Tim would not straight be on the show.
Because you would, because honestly, the original Last House on the Left is interesting for what it is, but it isn't really a fun movie to watch.
No,
or
I mean,
like
that's
or, and I don't even think it would yield much discussion. So no. It would strictly be to torture Tim.
Like, just by yourself, watch The Last House. Don't do it, Tim.
No.
Don't do it. I don't want you to do it.
Yeah, you make him watch it. And
I mean,
it's actually us talking. We watched another movie. We talked.
The one that came out in 2007 was bad enough.
No, well, you haven't seen the original, Tim. The original's great. Yeah.
It is, but it's...
But it's hard. Well, it's really hard to watch.
It is. It's worse content-wise, maybe.
Yes.
But better as a film.
And better as a story.
Yeah.
And it's a better payoff, weirdly.
Yeah.
It...
But don't watch it. We're talking to him like he's ever gonna see.
There's no chance. There's zero chance.
No way.
I do have a. Well, I think we can stop. Can we stop recording?
What? Can we what?
Can we stop recording?
No, we can't. We still gotta do. Wait, hold on.
I have
Tim.
I do have a list of Tim No movies.
Oh.
One of them
Why
is.
Why did you want us to stop recording?
I don't know, because one of them is.
Were you gonna call Tim
grave.
A? Were you gonna
I feel
call,
bad.
I thought you were gonna call Tim a bad word.
No, well, Tim's right here. Why would I call Tim a bad word?
Well, you call it to you would say it to him, but you wouldn't want a recorded version of it.
I would never say a bad word about you, Tim. You're my best friend.
That's not true.
Apparently, you'd say a bad word about me behind my back, though.
No, yeah, you're my best friend.
God, Christ.
I always say bad words about Michael behind his back because I could just do that.
Yeah, you do.
All right, I think we're all fucking loopy here. Because that's bullshit. No one would ever say a bad thing about me. I think we got to say what the next thing is and end it. Tim, it's a classic Tim pick.
Yeah, I was wavering between two films, and I think I've decided we're going to watch The Gray, starring Liam Neeson.
A slight correction. The classic Tim choice is actually going to be coming out on the 30th. And next week will be our Oscar special. Insha, you haven't seen that?
Is that the one with the wolf?
Yeah! Yeah,
yeah.
I've never
yeah.
seen that.
I know, she hasn't.
I'm excited, that'll be a good one.
I haven't seen it since I saw it in theaters when it came out. So I really
bought it on Blu-ray as soon as it came out.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see it again.
That's a little preview of whether I'm going to be a film runner, Walker girl.
So you, Insha, you haven't, I know you haven't seen it before.
I've never seen it. I've only seen the cover of it.
You've only seen the what?
I've only seen the cover of it. Like the cover of the film poster of it.
Okay.
Yeah, where it's all gray except for Liam Neeson's face.
Yeah, okay. I am excited to hear your fresh thoughts.
Although, I mean, we'll talk about it next week, but it'll be interesting to talk about preconceived notions, too, with regards to what the movie actually is.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
cool. Liam Neeson.
That's a good choice. Did I make you, Insha, did I make you watch The A-Team?
Oh, yeah. I love The A-Team.
Yeah, same director. Yeah, I fucking love The A-Team.
The A-Team rules so hard.
The new,
have you seen
yeah,
that?
Yeah, the
A-Team?
Newest one, right? The one that came out in
yeah,
like...
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I've seen it.
Yeah, I love that movie.
Is that guy
yeah,
still...
Yeah, same director.
Randy... No, not Randy Couture. Oh, Quentin Jackson. He's the... He plays...
Yeah, Rampage. Guy. Rampage Jackson. Yeah. Yeah. He's good. He's good.
He's really good, yeah.
Yeah. Bradley Cooper, almost perfectly cast as, like, a self-obsessed douchebag.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good cast. Good movie. I like it. Underrated, I think. That's another recommendation for people on the stairs is The A.T. Watch it.
Do the right thing. Oh, yeah. Check this out. Check this out. Check this out. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
talking about a black or white thing, cause that will cause conflict and make this illegit. But your definition of legit and illegitimate is confusing. Now the redhead wanna say, to make things clearer, cause in about a year or two, what you do is take a look up in the mirror, and what you see is the image of hate that you shed upon the others and sisters and your brothers. Now, in my opinion, you need someone to teach. The whole world is acting like a giant Howl Beach. I asked my man Victor what he used to do for fun. He said he learned to shoot a gun before the age of 21. Crime and abortion, all kinds of my distortion. This is very important, but just a little caution. And what you can do, that's a clue, and it's true. Yo, throw on a brand new sweater and make your life better. And do the right thing.
Do the right thing.
You got to do the right thing.
Did you tell him anything? If you did, you'll know what I'll do.
I killed your skinny friend in the walls. Now, what do you think of that? Oh, and I got him good. And the black one, too.
Shut the fuck up!